So we're going to go ahead and get started. To do so, I'm Dr. Grace Moorfield, and I'm the Associate Dean for Undergraduate. And what I'd like to do to get started is I'd like to go around the room, and I just would like to find out who's here. And I've got a little assignment for you. And the assignment is this: give me your name, where you're from, and in one word, you may go up to one partial sentence, no full sentence. Tell me, tell us, why you are here and what you would like to accomplish from being here, okay? So if you have an advertisement of something that's coming up, you can say, I would like to share, whatever you would like. Okay, so your name, and in less than a sentence, what brings you here? And we're gonna start at this end, and we're just gonna quickly pass the mic from person to person so we can get to know you just a little bit.
I'm Renee Poza. I'm Associate Dean here at the School of Nursing, and I hope to accomplish networking this morning.
Good morning, Jose Escobar, LA County Department of Public Health. And I would say learn and opportunities.
Hi, I'm Trisha Gandello from LA County Department of Public Health, PHN. And I'd also like to learn and network. That's two words.
Hi, I'm Leslie Newman from Children's Hospital Los Angeles, networking.
Hi, I'm Caitlin Catron. I'm an APU alumni and currently an educational mentor for the School of Nursing. I work at Loma Linda Children's Hospital, and I'm here to network and learn.
Hi, I'm Jason Tavares. I'm the contracts coordinator for the School of Nursing, and I'm here to work on placements and outreach.
I'm Cheryl Boyd, here from the School of Nursing. I'm faculty, and I'm here out of gratitude.
I'm Connie Brim, and I teach community health nursing, and I'm always all about networking and data for CCNE.
I'm Brianna Ida. I'm a senior nursing student, and I'm here for a leadership class.
Hi, I'm Lori Lang, and I'm the curriculum specialist for the School of Nursing, and I also teach leadership and management in undergrad. So I do have a few of my students here that are learning about these community relationships and our clinical partnerships, and just how important it is that we work together. So it's kind of part of that collaboration and communication. So it's just great to see everyone today.
Hi, I'm Emily Saunders, and I'm also a senior nursing student here for a leadership class.
Good morning, I'm Holly Nagatoshi. I'm from San Dimas Community Hospital, and I'm here to support the BSN program at our hospital.
Hi, my name is Yesenia Cabrera. I'm here from San Dimas Community Hospital, and I hope to accomplish better communication and partnership.
Hi, my name is Michael from Methodist Hospital. I'm here to learn just like everybody else. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Arlene Alexander. I come from Kaiser Permanente. I'm a clinical nurse educator, and I'm just happy to be here, happy to see all you smiling faces. All of you look so happy. And I'm here to collaborate.
Good morning. My name is Terry Lowe, and I'm the clinical nurse educator at Kaiser Permanente Baldwin Park, and I'm here to network and be reinvigorated.
I'm Dolly Martin Lovelace. I'm also from Kaiser Baldwin Park, and I am here to really express my gratitude, and I'm thankful to be here. I'm happy that the APU students come to Baldwin Park, and I want to express that joy, and that's why I'm here.
Hi, my name is Bianca Solis. I'm another one of the BSN students here to observe and learn for our leadership class today.
I'm Sophia Thomas. I'm also a BSN student, and I'm here to learn about nursing leadership.
My name's Amanda, and I'm an APU alum. I work at Foothill Presbyterian Hospital, and I'm here to learn and network.
I'm Melinda Dickin. I'm faculty in the undergraduate program and interim chair of the undergraduate. And I want to build relationships with their sites, and that will lead to better relations, better experience for our students, ultimately patient safety and good outcomes.
Hi, my name is Julie. I'm a BSM student. I'm here to listen and learn outside the clinical setting.
Good morning. I'm Benita Heiskis. I'm Associate Dean for the Graduate Programs at APU, and I'm here to network and connect with potential preceptors and learn. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ariana Smith. I teach in undergrad school of nursing, and one of the classes I teach is residency course, so I am here to express gratitude towards you for giving our students wonderful opportunities.
Hi, I'm Sarah Erickson, and I'm one of the BSN students, and I'm here to experience nursing leadership in practice.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Koi Parada, and I am a faculty member. I teach international and urban health nursing. I'm here to learn about your programs and see where our students can help build bridges to identify unmet medical needs.
Good morning, I'm Kathy McPhee. My new position is the coordinator of our academic practice partnerships, and so I'm here this morning to nurture those partnerships.
Hello, I'm Vianne Duncan. I am faculty for the undergrad, and I'm here because of the bacon.
That was a unique answer. Very good. Yes. It is good bacon. I'm Lynette Dahlman. I'm the Director of Clinical Education and Academic Partnerships at Huntington Hospital, and I'm here with gratitude and to reconnect.
Hi, my name is Michelle Valadez. I'm the Placement Coordinator at Huntington Hospital, and I'm here to learn and network.
Hello, I'm Angelica Acosta. I work at Huntington Hospital. I'm the new Grad Residency Coordinator, and I'm here to learn and meet everybody.
Hi, I'm Vicki Young, and I have a really unique opportunity because I work at Huntington Hospital. I'm a bedside nurse, so I get to work with the students, but also I'm an adjunct faculty member, so I get to see them at all levels.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Allison Burney. I'm the clinical director for ED, trauma, critical care, DOU, and behavioral health, and this is my first time here. So I would say just connecting and at Huntington, I apologize. Not at Kaiser or Children, but at Huntington. So it's my first time here, so just meeting people and connections.
Hello, I'm Dr. Linda Sirleach. I'm the Director of Nursing Research and Innovation at Huntington Hospital, and I'm here to celebrate nursing and meet BSN students that we might like to hire.
Hi, my name is Tracy Hara. I'm another BSN student from APU. And yeah, I know, perfect spot here. But yeah, I would just say to learn and observe about nursing leadership. So thank you.
So welcome, everybody. And I cannot express to you enough gratitude and thanks to our community partners. We obviously could not do what we do at APU without all of your hard work. You spend hours and hours placing our students, getting them good opportunities to learn, working with our faculty. You're amazing, and I, for one, and speaking on behalf of the School of Nursing, are so, so, so privileged and thankful for all that you do. So welcome. And I think what we're going to go ahead and do is just have Dr. Poza start. She's going to share with us, we're going to be talking about transforming primary care, implications for nursing education, and hopefully, as she presents, we'll have some good time for dialogue to be able to talk about where nursing is going and things that we can be involved in that process. So, Dr. Poza?
So, I echo Grace's sentiments of, you know, thanks so much to each of you for what you do for our students and our faculty and our programs here at APU. We really could not do what we do to educate the next generation of nurses without the excellent partnerships that we've formed over the years. So this morning when we were thinking about, you know, what would be topics of discussion for us, what are some of the things that we're talking about as nursing deans, we've had some recent meetings both at the state level as well as Dr. Lesh and myself have just come back from Washington, D.C., where we had the national meeting of the colleges of nursing, and so I thought maybe here's some of the things I thought we would present today and talk a little bit about, and then we'd love to have this be a time of discussion so that you can give us your feedback of, you know, some how is your healthcare system changing? Are there new nursing roles emerging, as we've seen many documents come out to talk about that? You know, what's the impact of healthcare reform on the clients that we're all serving? And I put a slide in here on, we heard it from a nurse futurist in DC, and so, you know, that has some implications. He had some thought-provoking things to share with us as nursing dean. So that's kind of what I thought we would do this morning. But to start, let me give you just a little update of where we are in the School of Nursing. So, and I think sometimes it's interesting to hear some workforce numbers. So Joanne Spetz was at our California meeting and was talking about some of our workforce numbers in California. So last year, California licensed for the first time about 11,000 new RNs. We've moved the needle on our BSN preparation in California. We're now at 61% in the state. 49% of nurses are still being educated in the ADN programs. And so that has implications for us in higher education as we align with those community colleges and partner with them for pathways for students, how they go from RN. So we might want to talk a little bit, Kathy, about our bridge program that we have with many of our community college partners. But the interesting thing for me when I looked at some of the numbers, I did the math. APU School of Nursing last year, we educated 16% of those new nurses. So we have a footprint in the state of California, and we can't do it without you guys. And so that's why these meetings are so crucial, that we partner with what you're doing in the clinical settings and how we are educating and designing curriculum and opportunities for students. The NCLEX pass rates were 86% for California. The nation is sitting at 83%. So California is doing a little bit better on those NCLEX pass rates. APU last year, our total program, we were at 84%. We do have a goal of being at 95% or better. So that is one of the areas that we continue to work on and have some challenges in that area. But at least we know we're almost up to the state level, right? But better than the national average in NCLEX. So a little bit, but what are we doing here in the School of Nursing? We are almost at 2,000 total enrollment in our programs. So we've felt the increase in enrollment. I look back to when Dr. Lesh became dean of the School of Nursing in 2005, and I was associate dean, and I think our total numbers might have been 400 or 500. So you can see the growth that we've done in the School of Nursing and our different programs. Just briefly, I'll share with you, we've launched an MSN in nursing education, both in an online format and a face-to-face, an MSN in healthcare administration and leadership, and that's a face-to-face and will be an online program as well. Those are two tracks now that are open to our entry-level master's students, so they have another option, so they don't have to go into advanced practice roles as part of their MSN program if they choose some of these other tracks to go in. We are actually working on launching public health, so be on the lookout for that, both probably at the bachelor's, the master's, and the doctoral level for public health. I see, Jose, you'll be interested in that, right? As LA County Public Health. and then we're also thinking about and designing, what would be a BSN to DNP. If you're not aware, the California BRN is the master's, the advanced practice, the NP rules and regs, which have been on the books since, I think, the 70s. They are now being revised, and they're moving through the process pretty quickly. The state in those documents is still going to be advanced practice at the master's level, although it does open the door for DNP level. So that is a discussion for us here in the School of Nursing, is do we move advanced practice all to DNP, or do we keep that MSN option. So, you know, I'm raising stuff that so that you guys can give us feedback too if you have comments about some of this stuff. We are coming up to a BRN visit in spring of 17, so our visit is actually the 28th, 29th, and 30th of March. And on the 30th, we will have our annual research symposium day, so the last day of our BRN visit will also be our research symposium, which I know many of you participate with that. So you'll probably see some BRN visitors at our meeting this year. If you don't know, a new executive director for the BRN was appointed. So Louise Bailey, who was the BRN executive officer, retired, and as of July 1st, Dr. Joe Morris was appointed into that position. So within his first 90 days, his biggest challenge has been the time it takes to get the application through the process and for new students to be eligible to sit for NCLEX, which, if you weren't aware, was taking 3 months, 4 months, 6 months. So they, I didn't realize how many touch points an application went through the process, but like six different hands and eyeballs were on that paper application. So they are moving everything electronically. They did a pilot with West Coast University, and as long as the school uploads electronically transcripts and the student doesn't have any flags on background or anything where it has to go into investigation, eligibility, now they're saying in 48 hours. So. There is a button on the website for the BRN, that every Monday gets updated and you can go right on there and see what the wait times or the processing times is. So I think we're gonna see some change with Dr. Morris and some of the processes in the BRN. So that's a significant impact for students that are trying to sit for NCLEX to get that process streamlined. So here within the School of Nursing, we've done a little bit of restructuring. So as you noticed, we have five associate deans now. So Dr. Heiskes is now the associate dean in charge of our graduate programs. Dr. Grace Moorfield is associate dean for our undergraduate programs, which then puts me into the old associate dean category. So I have a new title of a senior associate dean. but we're excited about some of these changes as it will allow new program chairs and the program chairs to have maybe smaller spans of care so that the faculty and the students that they serve can have a more hands-on relationship with department chairs. And we recognize that academic practice partnerships are so crucial to what we do that Kathy McPhee has a new position of full-time working with academic practice partnerships. So this is not only in the contracting piece and but the relationship, but I always say the worst thing we can do is enter into a partnership and then it doesn't sustain because either a faculty member retires or moves on and we know leadership changes within your institution. So we're really trying to, what can we put in place that have sustainable relationships, irregardless of as people move in and out. Last update, I guess I'll give you two more updates, but we are moving fairly rapidly into interprofessional education. So as part of my comments this morning, I thought it'd be nice to talk a little bit about what you guys are doing in interprofessional education. But within the university here, we have social work students, we have our department doctorate in physical therapy, our science students, as well as our nursing students. So we don't have a medical program here, but we do have a large undergrad science population that moves into medical schools. And so we are, as a university, talking about what does interprofessional education for us look like, and that will also have impact then into the partnerships and the opportunities that we're looking for you and what your needs are. And then finally, last quick update is we've asked for some increase in enrollment in our High Desert 2+2 program. This is our transfer program where transfer students go. We're asking the board for 10 more additional students. That would be another cohort of students up there. as well as our LVN to BSN program, a cohort of 20 students in Inland. When I looked at some of the workforce data, you know, there's always this debate, are we going into a nursing shortage again? Where's our needs gonna be? And Inland Empire really seems to be on the top of the list of a place we're gonna continue to have workforce needs out there. So you can keep us in your prayers on November 10th as we go before the full board of registered nursing to ask for this increase in enrollment. So I and I will be flying up to San Francisco, and Grace will fly to San Francisco to answer their questions. So I think anything question-wise, School of Nursing? That was a lot of information. Yeah, Connie.
Well, you mentioned the 2,000 students, but you
can
let everybody know we've got 5 campuses.
Yeah, so our footprint in Southern California is San Diego, Victorville, here on the Azusa, and we outgrew space here, so we have our building in Monrovia, if you haven't seen that building there. And that space there, it seems to continue to expand and grow. But we do have that's where our Institute of Health Research is, and most of our doctoral faculty and doctoral programs are there. Linda, you might want to take a tour sometime, because we are building a lab there so that we can house some of our students participate in biologic work and that. So Dr. Tyson heads that area. And then San Bernardino, Inland Empire. So two of our labs are gonna expand, both High Desert and San Diego are in working with architects to get more simulation space and lab space for students. So anything else? All right, so you didn't come to hear me talk, but I'm just gonna present a little bit of data and then open it up for some discussion so we can get some feedback here. But I was hoping to talk a little bit about what are some of the new roles that we're seeing emerging in the healthcare delivery system. You know, it's always the challenge with new roles is how do we prepare them and yet still prepare them for those acute care needs and those sick patients that you have and will continue to have. But as care shifts more maybe to the community and some of these different kind of settings, I remember actually as a new CNS, one of my big challenges was I was acute care focused in the med-surg units, in the ICU, and then I transitioned into an outpatient CNS role. And I knew the patient population and that it was the insurance, how do I call in a prescription? I mean, it was all that new outpatient world language. So how do we do that in our time constraints, I guess, for our undergrad students and prepare them, or at least expose them to some of that? And then talk a little bit about interprofessional education, and then maybe we can have a discussion about some of your workforce needs here. So I was recently in Brazil. I just threw this in because I was asked to give a talk at a national meeting in Brazil because they're exploring the role of the nurse practitioner. So they don't have advanced practice in Brazil. So that was a very interesting conversation. The physicians are asking for it in that country. And nursing, like we did in the 50s and 60s, I'm not sure we want to do this. So it was an interesting discussion. But it made me put together this pathway that we have for the profession of nursing. And you can see how complex we are in our education system. And then we have our doctoral programs and then our the DNP. And this, I think, is from a practice perspective, an emerging role. With new opportunities there. So I thought when I was looking at some of the literature and nursing role in primary care settings, so the reason that we thought this was a timely topic is for the first time, the Board of Registered Nursing is asking for where are your students in outpatient settings, where are they in ambulatory care, how are they getting these experiences, where do you have social determinants of health in your curriculum. So historically, the board has been very focused on these experiences need to be in acute care and are pretty prescriptive. So I think we're seeing a little bit of a culture shift in what the Board of Nursing is looking for, which then is gonna impact us in education as well. So sometimes it's called ambulatory care, sometimes it's called primary care, but then also even in specialty care, both in the outpatient setting as well as some of your acute care workforce needs, and I think I have a slide on this coming up too. And then we know transitions in community care is so important, and the impact there of all these people that have new methods of insurance or access to care. I was at a meeting with Senator Ed Hernandez a few weeks ago, and it was the Community Clinics Associations for LA. They have 700 openings in LA County for providers in the community clinics. So the workforce at the, just at the provider level in LA is huge. So you can imagine what at the nursing level within the community clinics. So we have some work to do, right? Some of our challenges there. And then transitions. There was a document recently, if, yes. So I think that gives, when you have a provider shortage, it's the conversation of where's the scope of practice, what our RNs can do, and what is an RN role in some of these, and how can, you know, there's some models out there where the nurse and the provider go in, the nurse goes in first, does the assessment, the history, the med reconciliation, comes out, gets the provider, this is what I'm recommending, provider goes in for a short period of time, does a quick little assessment what they need to do, and out the door. So how would we, as a School of Nursing, educating BSNs, how do we prepare the BSN to be able to step into a role like that? The Macy Foundation Conference had some recommendations. Some of the slides I have in here are documents that have recently come out and been published, and if you're not aware of them or don't have access to them, I'm certainly willing to, I have them all electronically, I can share them with you, so just let me know if you'd like a copy of any of these. But this was a conference looking at transforming primary care, and some of the recommendations were changing the healthcare culture, transforming the practice environment, how do we educate nursing students in primary care, how do we support the primary care career development of nurses, and then developing the expertise in nursing school faculty. You know, many of our faculty are working in acute care hospitals, so how do we develop this type of experience in our and level of competency in our faculty so then we can relay that to students in the curriculum as well, and then increasing opportunities for interprofessional education. One of the schools in this local area partnered, I believe with Kaiser actually, and they put their freshman level students in the Kaiser clinics with some good and bads. One of the challenges is how many nurse role model nurses are in clinic settings, and so you are they really just observing with the MAs? And then student perception was another challenge. So many of us and the educators in the room, and as well as your clinical educators, you know, students, and so I'm speaking for you guys here, right? You want the skills, and I need to start my IVs and put those tubes in, and then I'm a real nurse. So some of it was shifting the perception that, you know, this is real nursing, and how do we create those opportunities there? So. And then some of the healthcare delivery systems, and this is where we would like some feedback from you, is we seem to hear that we're shifting from acute care to disease management, and how do we do that, and what are the healthcare systems, how are you modifying so that it's more of a disease management focus? And then certainly the workforce needs in the specialty care area. So the Hospital Association of Southern California has put a workforce together, or a task group together, and we've been a part of that. It's now moving into the second phase, but they, along with Health Impact, have really identified that due to retirement in many of these areas, it's how do the hospitals have a workforce for ICU, ER, operating room. We're really hearing operating room as a need. And historically, the opportunities students have had to see operating room experiences have been less and less. So we were just, Kathy and I had a meeting yesterday talking about, you know, how can we, is there elective courses we could do, or how can we maybe expose some of our pre-licensure students a little bit more to the operating room so that they even have an interest of that upon graduation. And then perinatal areas seem to be what is kind of bubbling to the surface, but so you might have other ideas then too. And then this whole integrated team approach, which then moves us into interprofessional education and certainly greater role autonomy. And I think some of the talk is shifting from it's no longer an access to care for patients, but affordability and necessity. And how is nursing going to play a part in some of those discussions? And then certainly as we move into disease management, some of the things that we are challenged with in the curriculum is, you know, this idea of informatics, the use of big data, evidence-based practice, genetics and genomics, this personalized medicine, tailoring it, and continues to be the use of technology. I threw this in because I know we have some barriers across the state. So this is our, you know, we are not an independent practice state yet. So hopefully we can move that needle at some point. And then we're hearing lots of information about population health and the need for more content in this area. And I thought maybe I could give us a minute to the LA County Public Health Department, because they pulled a group of us in academia and practice together to talk about, you know, what are the workforce needs in public health nursing? How can we partner? And they also worked with California Action Coalition, CACN, and the directors of public health nursing. And you recently presented this work in Denver at the Public Health Association. There is a document, too, that's new roles in population health management that's coming out of the National Advisory Council on Nursing Education and Practice. It's calling for some funding reform, some curriculum for nursing school implication and research opportunities in this area. And then I want to mention the community care resources, like I talked about before with the clinics associations. But, you know, there's more and more federally qualified health centers that are in the LA area, and how do we partner with them, and what are those opportunities? As well as, I think we're seeing an increase in, you know, mobile vans, clinics. These are all things that traditionally we've never really thought of as opportunities for students in there. So here's a little bit, if you aren't familiar with Jeffrey Bauer, I would Google him and read some of his work. So he is a health futurist out of Washington, D.C., and we had the opportunity to have a one-hour session with him recently. So he gave us some statistics. So, you know, like, but looking in the future, is healthcare a viable place you want to be? So it's probably not going to see this huge growth like we've seen in the last decade as far as funding opportunities and money being infused into it. But he thinks there's probably about a 10% chance of growth in the healthcare arena. But what I thought was interesting was 35% of existing organizations or systems in healthcare will cease to exist as currently organized. So as we move into this next phase in the next 5 to 10 years, you know, he says, but 25% will thrive by fixing and reinventing themselves. So I think these discussions about innovation and new ways of doing things and how can we better provide care, probably knowing that we're not going to have an infusion of money into this. So, and I think this is where nursing is really poised to take leadership, you know. How we're good at, how do we deliver quality care with the resources that we have? That's what nurses do. So, but he really drilled home the point that I think we're all feeling, is that really looking at your partnerships are so critical, and how do you align with mission and vision and move the needle forward there. So his recommendation was that it's really looking at a 5-year plan with partnerships, using existing resources, and then increasing the partnership between academia and practice. He's got some books out as well as some articles in some of the recent health economic journals. Then another document is coming out of AACN, so a new Advancing Healthcare Transformation, a New Era for Academic Nursing. I think I touched on this at our last community of interest meeting maybe about a year ago. So the schools of nursing nationally are moving to, you know, how do we do this partnership and have some significant recommendations for, I think that it's trying to move away from the silos of the School of Nursing and the faculty are over here and the practice is over here and we sort of interact but not really intentionally interact. So I think this really is moving the needle forward on how do we intentionally interact, how does faculty participate in your process, how do you more intentionally participate in what we're doing at the education, because ultimately we're all in this for the same goal at the end. So I think I will close here with my comments and open it up to the group. So we'd like, I think it's probably best in group discussion so we all benefit from the comments that the group has. We have a nice array of partners in the room, both from community partners as well as acute care facility partners here. So how do you see your healthcare delivery system changing, either in the future or currently? How are you changing? And do you see a new RN roles in some of the new things and innovations that you're doing?
One of the things at Kaiser Baltimore Park, I'm in the acute care setting. I'm the director of education for the inpatient area. And I have an opportunity to work with our CNE and nursing leadership and things like that. So we have our acute care, hospital, and we have the whole system, the traditional systems. Then we also have our clinics. And we have found now that we, we have our value-based purchasing, the value-based healthcare, where the monies are going or not going. So what we have needed to do is really partner with our clinics, with our skilled nursing facilities that don't belong to us, but that we have contracts with. And we are now sending our education and training, like our WOCNs are going to the skilled nursing facilities to train them how to care for our patients and other patients as well, so that the patient doesn't come back to the emergency room, and then it's just a better outcome for the patient. In addition to that, we've had to reach out to our ED department. In our hospital, our ED is not under the acute care. They're under the ambulatory. So we have reached out to also train the not only the RNs there, but they have ERAs, they're like nursing assistants, to be able to at least be able to take off a dressing or turn a patient or prevent the initial skin injury when patients are on that gurney for whatever amount of time. So just the reaching out beyond just the acute care, knowing that down the line we will receive that benefit, and we're doing it ahead of time. Nobody's paying us to do this. We're actually having to put in the monies to pay for their salaries to do this. Does that make sense? So then you say, how do you see the emerging new roles, RN roles? These WOCNs, they're RNs, and they are under the cost center of the hospital. I can see the new roles being someone who is a liaison between the hospital and the skilled nursing facility, the home health, and things like that, as well as in the hospital. So that I can see that. That's it.
You talked about the workforce needs, and you saw the specialty with the workforce with HASC and everything, with the specialty ICU, perinatal, and all those. I think that the traditional model of education, clinical, going in alignment with the classes versus making the education patient-centric in the same way that healthcare is more holistic rather than just hospital-centric anymore, and the way everything's set up, to alter the clinical experience to mirror that. So make that patient-centric, so the med-surg clinical rotation would be more following the patient through from the acute care back to the SNF, similar to what you had said, and have the students within that semester actually follow the patient, develop partnerships, whether that's a liaison with a school, like Azusa, a hospital, and local community SNFs or something like that, LTACs, rehab units, primary care settings in the public health area, and follow the patient through within a core group. Most of those patients circulate within that medical home of theirs. And I think you could get the same med-surg experience, whether it's addressing change of the wound care nurse at a SNF or an LTAC or in the acute care, and with the short length of stays or the goal to reduce the length of stays in the hospital, you also get a more focus and a student that comes in seeing the whole picture rather than task-based nursing and needing to look at the whole patient.
I think you talked about the having students at the ambulatory setting as being a first-year student. I think the value is, of course, for our senior students who is about to graduate and having the opportunity to, you know, not just see the community or just having a home visit, but really seeing the big picture. So I think the value is, and I don't think we're doing a very good job partnering with service and education in terms of how to guide these students and faculty included and service provider as well, and what is that gonna look like in the future. And we're still bogged down to the clinic visit only and not really looking beyond those four walls. So I think that's where we need to partner in looking at how we can imagine that that's gonna be in the future. So.
From the community, based perspective, not from public health perspective, I see opportunities, and I heard presentations in APHA on acute care hospitals. Having nurses who have that knowledge of population health or community health, following the patient not just from that med surge to a SNF or to an ambulatory care, but also to the community. So why is the patient who's been discharged coming back, right, within 30 days or more? What is it that the community where this patient lives is missing? What resources are available? What resources are not available? How can we do that? How can we, from the hospital following the patient on like, okay, this patient is going to be discharged. Where is he or she gonna go? Does she have transportation, or where she live, is there transportation? Is there stores where, this patient can go buy her food or his food? So looking also at the community, so from the hospital to the community. I don't think there's a role like that yet, but having something like that where the hospitals get to know the communities where their patients are living, and just understanding, what those communities need, and then opportunities to partner, with Department of Public Health or other, community-based organizations.
Maybe you can speak without a microphone. Both of what you just said, I can mirror that. The meeting that Renee referenced yesterday, talking about the severe shortage of operating room nurses, and there's already surgeries around the United States being canceled. We do not have enough operating room nurses. So sitting in the room as a bunch of us created this on the wall, we realized 40, 30, 20 years ago, there were full rotations for nursing schools in the operating room, full rotations, scrubbing in, moving right in, that over the years was moved out, and we were not welcome. Students were not welcome in the OR. The situation now for operating room nurses, they have to have a year experience. Where do they get it? So during our conversation, we talked about what you just mentioned, following, and even I as a clinical instructor, when my students' patients would go to the OR, they would stay in the unit. So we're gonna ask the hospitals for help as our curriculum looks at, because our undergrads do have a brief experience in the operating room, they're introduced to it, but why can't the students follow their patient? When they go to surgery, follow the patient, maybe observatory, definitely at least recovery room. And so in integrating with them, because we have to nurture their excitement about the operating room early, because they have no clue what it is.
And all the ADN schools, no rotation. They don't rotate them through. So those are some of the things I think where we talk about the patient focus rather than the course focus.
And some of those restrictions on being in the operating room are coming from ARN and limiting the number of people that are in the surgical environment to reduce the risk of infection. So it's been a self-fulfilling prophecy where you don't have the people that you need there to learn in that environment. I mean, exactly, we've created it. And we see the need, and we're kind of facing the same thing. We want to have students in the OR, and we're being told, no, they can't, because the ARN says, you know, you have to limit the number of people in there, and we have lots of people that go in and out of that room. Allison, I'm sure, is going to have a lot to talk about behavioral health in just a second. But to go along with the needs of the students, I love the idea of that whole tracer methodology to kind of follow the patient through. And you, in your senior kind of capstone, have an opportunity to do something like that because they're not really taking a lot of other courses. I don't know how many other universities have it that way, where there's some options around being able to go to clinical every day and follow a patient as they go through that continuum of care. But I see a role of maybe a nurse navigator / care coordinator, which would be a good liaison kind of a role in the community that would be more able to help the patient. We have navigators in the hospital for disease-specific issues, but we don't necessarily have navigators for navigating the healthcare environment in whole. And I have a friend who has been a nurse for 40 years, and that's what she does now privately. She hires herself out to help families navigate healthcare. And she then goes with patients to their visits and to the doctor's office and to their other acute care things so that they understand and they know what questions to ask. So there's a niche there. She's taking advantage of that and doing it as her own private business. But I think behavioral health is a big issue.
Hi, I have a question and then a comment. In all of these meetings in DC and where you've been, has behavioral health come to the top? Because what we're seeing, and I think probably our friends over there in public health, is just a shortage, number one, of qualified people who are interested in psych, and then just the sheer volume of patients that are coming through our ED. And so what we have started is a partnership in Pasadena with Pasadena Public Health, the hospital, as well as CHAP Clinic, which serves the underserved, and I think that, and Union Station, which we actually pay for beds at Union Station, and we're able to transition some of our behavioral health homeless people there for beds. And so I think, all of that being said, I think that there's perhaps an opportunity to invite APU to the table in that discussion, because CHAP Clinic is a wonderful resource, and somehow if we would partner and be able to have your students experience, it really goes into that flow. So, you know, the patient is seen in RED and then goes to Union Station and then is referred to CHAP Clinic for their continuity of care. So it's a great way to start, I think, with a dialogue around psychiatric patients and the homeless population. So just did psych come to?
So in many of the conversations, the issue of mental health, behavioral health does come up, as well as some of the challenges. You know, many times as we move into more integrated systems where the patient has one place that they seek a lot of different resources and care, with one of the challenges being if they're going to see a provider, then if they also see the mental health provider, they can't, it's considered double billing, right? So just some of our infrastructure barriers that we have to overcome. But I think in all meetings, this is a continuing issue, and more needs to be done with that.
You were speaking a little earlier about where are these online nurses getting their community health, and that's a big question. We have a number of our AA students who are going back for their BSN through Western Governors University. And, you know, at the outset, you kind of have this trepidation about an online school. But what we've done is for our nurses who need the community nursing piece of that, we piece together that opportunity for all of the system-related outpatient settings that we provide at the hospital, and then we create that opportunity for them. So they do everything from our ambulatory clinic to working with our nurses that go out in community health outreach. They work in our cardiac rehab center and work with those patients. They partner with nurses who are in our senior care network, who there's their home visit. They get to go out to do a home visit with that. They even go on blood drives and work with our blood drive nurses. So we make sure that for our own nurses who are getting their BSN, that they get the community experience of our community. And so that's how we do that. I don't know how anybody else does it, but at least we make sure that they're doing something that is truly holistic for our community.
Just have a very brief comment, because we're really here to hear from you, but I do have a group of students at Union Station. We will be visiting CHAP and Huntington this semester. Mostly we're at the Centennial Place, which is part of Union Station, and it's exactly as you say, and it's a great partnership. That was the first thing. The second thing is I'm hearing a lot of talk about community and public health, and they're not quite the same. Public health is the more traditional role of population-based and communicable disease control and prevention and, you know, big and government and official and, you know, that sort of thing. And that's the public health. And sometimes people use them interchangeably, whereas community is community-based or community-oriented nursing. And we are seeing more of that. One of the concerns I have is there's a lot of people out there giving care in the community, but is it supervised? Is it at a professional level? Because there are a lot of people called case managers and home health aides, and, you know, they're all good people, and their hearts are in the right place, but they're much, usually paid at a lower rate, so they're very attractive to agencies, whereas we come at a little higher price tag, and so I get concerned about where is professional nursing in all of this.
Back to acute care for a minute. I would like to advocate, support your idea of offering electives, because it's very difficult to take an impacted curriculum and add more, you know. But doing electives are also, they're faster to do for that reason. But I really think it's very valuable. My own experience was I took an elective in cardiac nursing, and it just, that's my career. That's what started my career. And it was really important because I really didn't like the other areas of nursing. So it was kind of worrisome in my senior year. So very valuable. So I'd like to see you do that for the OR, because I think there's a lot of things we can do about OR nursing outside of the OR. I know, like Keck Medical Center, for example, you can see them via video. It's kind of telemedicine, actually, but you don't have to be in the OR to see the operation and the nurse's role and all those things. And then I would like to recommend that you do an elective around innovation. It's very much linked to evidence-based practice, but you can learn how to do evidence-based practice in a lot of your programmatic work. But what we don't teach very well is how to successfully implement changes. And innovation is, there's principles and theories around this that help you be successful. And that would be very valuable for a BSN graduate coming out of your program. If you had an elective like that, I would hire those people. Not that I do the hiring, but, you know, just to be clear.
And I have to thank this community of interest here, because a few years ago when we were redoing our curriculum, that was a recommendation that you made, and we do have a course now, UNRS 444, which is a 1-2 unit preceptorship, and Ariana Smith has been managing that, and we're flooded with students, and so we're actually trying to figure out how to manage the interest level in that. But thank you.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, thank you.
We're coming to the end of our time here, so I just wanted to move us to if there's any last comments about, you know, okay, Connie, with your CCNE hat here, we're going to ask them what's the strengths of our program and if there's anything that we could do better. So if just in closing, if there's an opportunity for you to give feedback of things that you would like us as a school of nursing to know. And I think there were some surveys also as well, right? So if you guys can complete your surveys, we're always asked by our evaluators to, you know, how are our students doing? How are they functioning when you hire them for the first time, as well as tracking down our alumni and how do the alumni feel about that? So. If you don't have numbers, and just take it back with you and then get it back to us at a later time.
We're actually going to be sending you a follow-up request for information, so you'll see that in an email shortly.
Any closing comments or anything we didn't touch on? I know it's a short period of time to have this big discussion, but I think in future meetings we can continue the dialogue, but I really look forward to the creating some of these new and different and innovative opportunities. So we thank you for your partnership.
And they may be seeking for visits.
And Kathy will visit you, yeah.
Lori,
you want to comment?
One's a bit of a political announcement. I'm going to invite you to the Association of California Nurse Leaders annual program in February at Disneyland Hotel. I'll be doing a presentation there on the research priorities for nursing leadership. It's a study that I led that was sponsored by ACNL, and there are no other priorities out there around nursing leadership. Some around nursing administration, but they're different. So that's one trend I think that will be coming out, more support for research on leadership development among nurses. And then at our own facility, we're a collaborative of four magnet hospitals conducting research around implementing a program to improve gero care for our older patients, 65 and older. And the program is evidence-based, and we expect it to reduce length of stay and complications and fewer transfers to ICU. It includes interprofessional team approach to care for these patients. It's actually interdisciplinary. Nurse-led, so the role of the nurse is key in this program. We have a geriatric clinical specialist who I'm working with, and she's going to lead the implementation and lead the rounds, lead the team. And then the nurses are going to do systematic assessment of frailty. And as we implement this program, the NEACH initiative, as I'm sure you're aware of, will be using their work and their evidence-based protocols to guide our interventions. And so that's all inside the hospital. And then we have a senior care network division that looks at after discharge for our community. And they have the opportunity to extend this program once the patient is outside. So the other hospitals have not ever done that part, so that'll be unique to Huntington. And then, of course, the research around that will lead to recommendations around extending this program nationwide. So that's a kind of a huge leadership element around spreading innovation, but then the specifics are around older patients.
Thank you. It's 9 o'clock. We said we'd get you out of here by 9 o'clock, so we're going to get you out of here at 9 o'clock. But I wanted to close us with a blessing. I would like to bless you. So let's just pause for a minute. May the Lord bless you, students, alumni, faculty, and most of all our community partners. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and give you rest. Bless you. You may stay as long as you want and chit chat. Give us more information.